Hi everybody, I'm Rebecca with Cherish Children Ministries. Welcome back to my channel. Today I'm gonna talk to you about the integration of primitive reflexes and some tips to help your dyslexic child spell a little bit better. And then what do we do about curriculum? These are questions that I have been asked a lot over the past few weeks whenever I've been working with moms and different kids. So I'm just gonna go ahead and address those today. With primitive reflexes. What are they? And then what did they do? And why do we need to integrate them? So primitive reflexes actually serve two purposes. So first of all, initially, they serve an infant for survival and protection. And then later, the neural pathways formed by the process of reflexes being activated and becoming integrated actually provide the neural structure that facilitates learning in the most natural and efficient way. Integration of primitive reflexes refers to the reflex becoming latent, so to speak, within the brain, the body, thus no longer controlling the body's movements upon stimulation of a reflex, but ready to emerge again if it's needed for survival or protection. So the presence of integrated reflexes in children really might result in development delays, thus interfering with a child's ability to learn and develop in the most efficient way. Now that is not to say that a child cannot or will not develop, but as the child attempts to master skills using less efficient neutral pathways, and fatigue, stress, and poorer than desired performances are very likely. If there is a child that has multiple unintegrated reflexes, difficulties may be seen in the form of poor attention, language and learning weaknesses, reading delays, including dyslexia, poor or labored handwriting, visual system disturbances, and social and emotional immaturity, including anger management. And this really does result in eye stress and eye strain, fatigue, poor reading fluency, and reduced comprehension. Another thing that we like to test for and to do exercises for is called eye teaming or convergence. So poor convergence skills might result in double vision or blurred vision or even severe or discomfort of any near work. This discomfort may reveal itself through hard blinking or even rubbing of the eyes and may cause visual fatigue, poor comprehension, and a need to reread texts several times to gain meaning. So I like to implement some different exercises and strategies to help balance the brain. It's basically one side of the brain maybe overperforming the other side or underperforming the other side. So we want to try to give it a healthy balance. So the first thing that we do is that we test for is visual tracking. Poor eye movement control results in an inability to keep one's place when reading. And I see this a lot with my own son who is dyslexic. Now this can happen either in rereading or skipping individual words or entire lines. When tracking skills are poor, higher centers of the brain must control the eye movements when in fact the eye movements should be automatic and driven by lower brain centers. Therefore, much more brain energy is spent to move one's eye across a page. These kids have reduced handwriting skills and they often get headaches. Another exercise we do is visual motor handwriting form copy. So handwriting is a highly complex task for developing children. Some characteristics that we often see when the visual motor skills necessary for handwriting are not fully or properly developed are these. These kiddos have poor letter formation and a tendency to draw letters like from memory. They often press too hard when writing, and this causes their hands to tire really quickly. Oftentimes they have poor posture when writing or not an improper grasp or an inefficient pencil grasp. They oftentimes lean their head on their arms when they write. They have poor penmanship. With few exceptions, they can be traced to unintegrated reflexes of the hand, the arms, or the trunk. So in regard to academic achievement and learning, poor visual motor skills inhibit a person's ability to express language in written form. Another one is phonological awareness. Now, this actually refers to the brain's ability to discriminate between speech sounds and to process the number and order of sounds in words. A hallmark characteristic of dyslexia is poor phonological awareness. Now, this can refer to skills that have not yet been paired with alphabet letters for meaning, like rhyming and syllable counting, as well as connecting meaning to letters, which is also known as sound symbol correspondence. Children with poor phonological awareness skills will definitely struggle with decoding or sounding out words in early grades when they are learning to read. These kids actually tend to remember the whole words by sight rather than figure them out by sounding out the word. Poor phonological awareness represents weaknesses in the left hemisphere of the brain. And this is the part that is the primary hemisphere for processing speech sounds. And we've talked about this in one of my earlier videos. Now, academically, this has a profound effect on all areas of learning as it results in poor reading skills to varying degrees depending on the severity of the deficit. Another exercise and skills we like to look for are motor skills. That includes balance, midline crossing, and bilateral integration. So, outward observable motor skills reflect the inner neural patterns of each of the brain's hemispheres. Poor balance negatively affects motor coordination and stability at a basic level, and both visual and auditory processing at higher levels of the brain. An inability to cross the body's invisible midline represents delays in the development of the corpus callosum, which is the network of the brain fibers that connects the two hemispheres and allows them to efficiently communicate with one another. Whole brain processing is needed in order to be an effective reader. It allows the left hemisphere, which is used for decoding and ordering sounds and words, to easily communicate with the right hemisphere, which is used for seeing the big picture that is needed for comprehension and complex sentence structure. Now, similarly, bilateral integration skill observed through large body movements reflects the level at which the two hemispheres are able to work together and process as a whole unit. So the next thing I want to talk to you about is spelling. I hear a lot of moms ask questions about, my dyslexic child doesn't know how to spell. I don't know how to help him or her learn how to spell better. But remember, if you go back to the dyslexic child that is better in right brain than left brain, and then left brain is that part that's needed for the word form area. Remember, that has to be ignited first. Remember, these kids are very visual learners. So I actually like to have a lot of fun with this and build words. So you can see some pictures of the words that we build and how we go about it. I can just take a book. I really like to use big books for the littler kids, but for the older kids, of course, use what works for them and what they're interested in. But I love to just make words with these books and take a special sound, and I just use paper. You can use sticky notes, you can use labels. I've seen people like actually use a white, like whiteout, and actually draw the letters on them, but you can use whatever works for you, like whatever system works for you. I have little toolboxes that I have around our house and at the school in which I help these kids. So I have little toolboxes that I've made. So I will make another video on those toolboxes if you want me to. If you drop a comment below to let me know if you'd like to see what's in the toolboxes and what you can do to make your toolbox for yourself. I like to have a lot of fun with this, and I just take little animals and I'll put special sounds on the animals, like claw or shun, T-I-O-N, or like in morning. And I was actually reading the book down by the station. So I took a couple of those special sounds and we would build words with that. Also, what we can do is we can just make words out of Play-Doh. You can have your kiddos actually tap the words on their arm. So you might say was, W-A-S, was, there are a lot of different ways that you can do this. You can do volcano spelling, where you start at the bottom, you reach down at your ankles, and you just spell the word moving up to your knees, into your hips, into your shoulders, and then explode the word when you get to the finale. Those are just some fun things that you can do. But I will tell you that none of this will work until the phonics, the phonemes, none of those will work until we have actually had some brain exercises to get that left brain active and working. I put the alphabet all over like some Legos, or you can use party favors, or you can use blocks, you can use Scrabble letters, you can use dice, you can use anything that you have. I don't think that I would really worry about spelling so much yet, especially until the brain therapies are used on the child so they can ignite that side of the brain. Because really, you might see a little bit of progress, but in all honesty, you're probably gonna see a little bit, but then some regressing. And we know with these kids, they really need to celebrate those wins. They really need to feel successful because they have that low self-esteem anyway. So I would just really recommend taking a step back, not stressing about a spelling curriculum right now. So I don't like to encourage my clients to spend hundreds of dollars on something until we have learned how to integrate primitive reflexes and to ignite the side of the brain that needs that ignition for the curriculum to actually work. So actually, there's a whole lot of history behind that too. And I'm actually including that history in another class that I'm doing. But again, if you want to know more about that, can you just drop me a comment below telling me that you would like to know more about that? Just really focus on those wins. Make the spelling list short. Definitely try to integrate those words throughout your day. Definitely don't make them isolated. If you see the word and you want to choose maybe 5 words for your week, go find those words on the newspaper. Go find those words in your reading book with whatever you're reading. Go find those words in a magazine. Go find those words at a restaurant or at a store. Go someplace and find those words in real life so that it can make meaning to the child. So that's really what I would recommend for spelling. And then the final thing is curriculum. What curriculum should I use? So I sort of addressed this with spelling. Really, I would advise you not to invest in any one big curriculum right now until your child has implemented all of the primitive reflexes and done all of the brain exercises and therapies first. Because what we're seeing is, even in our teenagers who struggle with dyslexia, we're seeing regressions where parents don't know what to do and teachers don't know what to do. And the reasons are because we haven't really taken care of the main problem, being that the primitive reflex integration and the therapies and the exercises that we need for that brain to ignite for the wonderful curriculum to be used. So if you have any more questions about that, make sure you drop those in the comments below as well. Well, I think that's all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to know more about the dyslexic learner, make sure that you subscribe. Just go to the website, or you can click the link below and subscribe and get the latest updates.